I'm Gan from MSR Cambridge, and this is joint work between MSR Cambridge and Windows Azure. So this talk is about how to share the network in multi-tenant data centers. And multi-tenant data center includes public cloud environment like Windows Azure, Amazon EC2, where anyone can rent virtual machines and become tenants. Although we focus on the public cloud data center, this can be also applied to private data centers as well. So now let's consider a popular example use case called MapReduce Data Analytics. And as you can see, a blue tenant is running MapReduce. It generates traffic between its VMs, and we call this intra-tenant traffic. And tenants typically stores data in the storage services, which is another tenant. So traffic between storage services and VMs can be an example of inter-tenant traffic. And there are other tenants in the cloud that shares the network. And because network is shared, a performance of a blue tenant can vary depending on other tenants' activity. And this is the problem that we focus on this talk. So given that network is shared, let's see how we should how the network should be shared. So I'm showing three key requirements that we target in this work. First, tenants want either predictable performance or cost, or even both. And for network, predictability translates to minimum bandwidth guarantee. And second, some tenants pay more than others. Naturally, higher paying tenants should be given more bandwidth than lower paying tenants, which we call proportionality. And third, both provider and tenants can benefit from using spare resources as much as possible. So the third requirement is high utilization. And in fact, these three requirements are not new, and many prior work has addressed them. However, most of today's data center only provides high utilization. And there has been many researches targeting the problem. I'm not going into details, but the key point here is that no prior work satisfies all three requirements. And it has been shown that minimum bandwidth guarantee and some definition of proportionality are not compatible. And furthermore, all this prior work focuses only on intra-tenant traffic. However, we find that inter-tenant traffic is prevalent in today's data center, and worse yet, inter-tenant traffic makes minimum bandwidth guarantee harder and proportionality more problematic. So I'll explain this in next few slides. So first, let's see what inter-tenant traffic might be in the data centers. Typical cloud-based web services have many dependencies, and this could be depend on provider services or even third-party services. So for example, in Amazon Web Service Marketplace, there are lots of companies offer software as a service, such as firewalls, WAN optimizer, or web caching today, and we believe this will increase. And here, I'm showing the fraction of inter-tenant traffic from 8 data centers from a major public cloud provider. And as you can see, there are a significant amount of inter-tenant traffic ranging from 10 to 35%. So now, let's see why inter-tenant traffic brings more challenges to the network sharing requirements. So first is minimum bandwidth guarantee. For minimum bandwidth guarantee, we need to make sure that there is enough bandwidth on every link that traffic flows. So let's consider this example where there's one tenant. If to provide minimum bandwidth guarantee for intra-tenant traffic, we need guarantee only on two links that are shown in blue. But if we consider inter-tenant traffic, these VMs can communicate with any other VMs in the data center, which means that we need to make sure there's enough bandwidth in all the links in the data center. So as we allow inter-tenant traffic, it leads to richer communication pattern, thus guaranteeing minimum bandwidth becomes harder. Another challenge with the inter-tenant traffic is defining proportionality. So in this example, there are three tenants, P, Q, and R, and P and Q have dependency on R. So P has one flow from R, and Q has three flows from R, and these flows are VM level flows. Although P and Q are paying same amount, all existing schemes allocate more bandwidth to Q, which is not desirable because they're paying same amount. More broadly speaking, when there is a flow between two independently paying tenants, it's not clear how to combine two payments to decide bandwidth for the flow. So the proportionality is tricky here. So to solve these problems that I described earlier, we propose Hadrian. With Hadrian, we try to answer three following questions. So first, what network abstraction the provider should offer to tenant so that tenant can reason about their performance in the data center in the presence of inter-tenant traffic? And for a given network abstraction that we propose, how should provider allocate bandwidth and how to place virtual machines so that provider can actually meet the requirements? So from now on, I'll explain virtual network abstraction that Hadrian uses. So we start from the state-of-the-art called host model. So host model provides an illusion that all the VMs of a tenant is connected to virtual switch with capacity B on each link. So tenant asks for a number of VMs and capacity B, and each VM can send and receive at a rate of B. And this model is the most popular way in today's research. And from this model, the difference, our model also allows tenant to use more bandwidth when there is spare capacity. So it provides high utilization, and tenants still get the minimum bandwidth guarantee from the host model. So now let's consider a case of multiple tenants. As I mentioned earlier, we would like to model traffic between these tenant schedules. So to allow inter-tenant traffic, first we propose multi-host model. So in this model, all tenant VM are connected to one giant switch using its own capacity. So with this model, inter-tenant bandwidth would be dictated by intra-tenant bandwidth requirement, which assumes that inter-tenant traffic and intra-tenant traffic requirements are the same. However, we observed that from our public cloud trace that tenants have locality in the traffic, meaning that there is more intra-tenant traffic than inter-tenant traffic. And to reflect this, we propose a second abstraction called hierarchical host model. In this model, tenant specifies inter-tenant bandwidth requirements separately, so each tenant has its own virtual switch for intra-tenant traffic, which is then connected to one giant inter-tenant switch. So unlike intra-tenant, inter-tenant bandwidth requirement is assigned per tenant, which is good for tenant because small subset of VMs can utilize whole inter-tenant bandwidth if necessary. However, this model still assumes all-to-all communication, which makes it almost impossible to guarantee the bandwidth at large scale. So as a solution, we propose communication dependency. We observe that most tenants communicate with only small number of other tenants, so we let tenants specify dependency in the request. And this information reduces possible communication pattern and also helps placement algorithm to put dependent VMs closer so that overall network load is reduced. And there are service tenants, such as storage service, who'd like to communicate with any other tenants. For this, we allow wildcard dependency. So far I described the virtual network abstraction that we provide. So now I explain bandwidth allocation in the strategy in Hadrian. So in this work, we propose a new bandwidth allocation scheme called host compliant bandwidth allocation. So let me explain this with an example. There are two VMs P and Q, each with bandwidth requirements of 100 and 200 megabits per second. And the question is, whose payment should dictate the bandwidth of the flow in the middle? We assume that payment for the network is proportional to the bandwidth requirement, and each VM distributes this payment uniformly across all flows. In host-compliant bandwidth allocation, we propose taking minimum from two sides, which is 20 in this case. So we can generalize this as an equation, as you see, assuming weighted fair share network, we can define weight W as minimum of bandwidth divided by N onto size. And whose compliant bandwidth allocation satisfies a nice property which we propose and call upper bound proportionality. So in this example, VMP has five flows, and no matter what bandwidth allocate other guy on each flow, the sum of weights for all these five flows will never exceed 100. In other words, upper bound of tenant's flow total weight is same as the bandwidth and proportional to the payment. And this is the key property that allows us to guarantee the minimum bandwidth. So let's look at this example, which is similar to what I've shown earlier, where P has one flow and Q have many flows. And both have bandwidth guarantee of 500 megabits per second. So if you recall, all existing schemes allocated more bandwidth in Q, and which makes it impossible to guarantee 500 megabits per second on P. In Hadrian, because VM's total weight is bounded by payment, so both Q and P's weight will never exceed 500 in this link, which means total will never exceed 1,000, which leads to minimum bandwidth guarantee of 500 megabits per second for both tenants. And for the same reason, our placement algorithm can ensure that the total weight on every link does not exceed capacity, which leads to the minimum bandwidth guarantee across the data center. And we can formulate this problem as a max flow network problem, which guides the placement algorithm to verify the placement. And okay. So far I described Hadrian's concept and mechanisms. So to evaluate the benefit of Hadrian in the data center, we use synthetic cloud workload benchmark. So it models a tenant as some CPU processing and intra-tenant traffic and inter-tenant traffic. Throughout the benchmark, many tenant requests a job, runs it, and leave the data center. And placement algorithm can either accept or reject it depending on the availability. And to reflect the real world, we draw a few simulation parameters that relate to the inter-tenant traffic from the measurement result. We run this benchmark in small-scale testbed with the 16 hosts, and also run flow-level simulator at a large scale of 16K hosts. And throughout the evaluation, we first look at whether Hadrian actually delivers all three network sharing requirements that we defined. And second, we quantify benefit of Hadrian using synthetic cloud workload that I described earlier. And we compare Hadrian against per flow sharing, which is representative of today's data center using TCP, and also some prior work, Octopus and Faircloud when it is possible. So this graph shows the relative job completion time against the worst case job completion time estimated by bandwidth requirements of a tenant and the workload of a tenant. So first, we see that baseline has a 3.4 times completion time at 95th percentile, meaning that some tenant suffers from insufficient bandwidth. And Octopus here refers to hard reservation, meaning that no high utilization. And as you can see, both Octopus and Hadrian finishes within the deadline in the worst case. While Hadrian has lower completion time in general because of high utilization. So this result shows that Hadrian meets minimum bandwidth guarantee and high utilization. So now we look at the bandwidth allocation in the scenario that I shown earlier. So as you can see, on the right side, I'm showing the bandwidth that are acquired by tenant P. And as you can see, Hadrian allocates 500 megabits per second regardless of number of flows in Q, while all other schemes allocate less bandwidth for P. And this is possible because of upper bound proportionality. So far I've shown that Hadrian meets all three network sharing requirements. Now let's see what benefit Azure can offer in terms of request acceptance ratio. So here I'm showing the overall request acceptance ratio for testbed in green bars and simulator in red bars. And we compare baseline and Hadrian, and as you can see, Hadrian accepts about 37% more jobs. And testbed and simulator shows consistent results, which gives us confidence in the results. We also run the simulation in large scale and observe the similar benefit of 20% more jobs getting accepted while VM level occupancy was lower. And this tells us that Hadrian is actually efficient than today's data center. So to summarize, we observe that inter-tenant traffic is prevalent in today's data center. We propose Hadrian as a network sharing solution in multi-tenant data centers. It consists of three major components: virtual network abstraction, host-compliant bandwidth allocation, and placement algorithm. And our evaluation shows that Hadrian can meet all three network sharing requirements we target, and it leads to predictability and more efficiency. So thank you for listening.
Rajesh Nishtala from Facebook. Mm-hmm. Can you comment about the multi-tenancy of low latency, low bandwidth applications and high latency, high bandwidth, high latency tolerant applications coexisting in one environment in this kind of model?
So right, latency is kind of out of scope in this work, but in general, if you reserve bandwidth and doesn't allow like network getting overutilized, it helps the latency, but it's not covered in our work. So,
okay, thank you.
Hi, Sanjay Rao from Purdue. So how easy is it to predict the inter-tenant bandwidth? Does this change a lot over time?
So that would depend on like application. But for if you imagine MapReduce that you already know like what's the data size, total data size that you stored on the storage services and how much fraction of them you're gonna read, and if you have a deadline that you have in mind, it's kind of easy to reason about like what's the bandwidth that you will need, right? So it would entirely depend on the application, but I believe there are applications that are actually easy to reason about inter-tenant bandwidth requirements. Does that answer to your question?
Yeah. So are you sort of assuming it's given to you, or do you sort of dynamically adapt to?
So we assume tenant specifies the bandwidth requirements when they come to the data center and request for VMs. That's the assumption.
And the other question is, how complex are these dependencies across tenants? For example, if A is dependent on B and B is dependent on C, you may need to place A, B, and C all together close, right? So do you do things of that nature?
So the inter-tenant bandwidth that we specify, it's all across other tenants and all the other tenants. So you don't really need to care about like whether B is dependent to the other. So as a tenant, you only need to think about what's the total bandwidth that you need for all the communication with other tenants. And given that most of tenants actually depends on like small number of other tenants, it should be plausible for them to reason about it, I think.
Okay, thank you.
You know, we have a few minutes, so I was wondering if you would indulge one of my questions, which is I wanted to ask you a little bit more about services. Mm-hmm. Because as you mentioned, like if you have all-to-all communication, the placement problem is really tricky.
Yes.
And services are one of those things where you run the risk of being over-constrained because like everyone wants to talk to the storage layer, for example. Mm-hmm. So I was wondering if as part of your placement framework, you might be able to incorporate some sort of hint to the storage layer where you could say something like, well, if it's all the same to you, maybe you should put all of this tenant's data in this particular spot on this particular place in the storage layer, because that's going to make the network placement problem much easier. I was wondering if you could say anything about kind of opportunities for co-design there between the services and the placement stuff.
So I'm sure if you consider a service tenant where you would like to talk to pretty much anyone, it would be there should be plenty of opportunities to optimize, like spread them across the racks if you already know that pretty much everyone accesses you. In this work, we did not consider them. So in our work, we did not consider whether it's going to be like serving thousands of tenants or not. But I'm sure that can guide the placement to do a better job in terms of placing service tenants. Yep. Good. Thank you.
All right. Let's thank Steve again.